Good evening and welcome to the July 6th meeting of the Issaquah Development Commission. Tonight, we will be looking at this is a public, obviously a public meeting, and the process will be explained. For those of you who don't have a copy of it or didn't look at it, there will be approval of minutes, which is the next item. Then there will be a session primarily for the benefit of members of the commission for that is a review of the process that is involved with our work here. And then the agenda item is a site development permit application for applicant SDP16-0004. And that will be the primary thing that we'll be doing this evening is looking at presentation by the city. There will then be a part of this will be and the applicant, and then we'll have questions, clarifications, and so on by members of the commission. There's also a sign-in sheet there. There isn't a part the public comment, but we're going to do that today. If there's anybody that would like, member of the public that would like to be heard on this, we'd ask you to sign in, please. And then when you come up, when you come up to the microphone, if you'd give your name and your address, if you'd like to be on the record, okay? All right, with that, the first item is the approval of the minutes. Are there any corrections, deletions, additions? If not, can we get a second?
Mr. Chair,
move
we approve the minutes from the June 8th Development Commission meeting?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion of the minutes? If not, all those in favor of approval? Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Ayes have it. It's unanimous, in which case we'll now go to Christopher.
All right, thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Christopher Wright, and I'm the Project Oversight Manager for the Development Services Department. And in the interest of continuing to train you, especially the new members, but also as a refresher for some of you old timers, we thought we would take a few minutes to go over kind of what the Development Commission's purview is and what kind of applications you see and why. This is a list of the different types of applications that you see. There are site development permits, SDPs, which is what you're reviewing this evening. Community conference, which is kind of a preliminary meeting that you do for some site development permits, and I'll get to that in a minute. Master site plans, development agreements, and then some signs. I put that in there for you, Mel.
Thank you, Mr. Wright.
Because there are some signs, if they are outside of an urban village, outside of central Issaquah, on a major street, new signs, not replacing existing signs, that would come to the Development Commission. And we'll be evaluating whether Development Commission is going to continue to review signs sometime in the next year or so, hopefully, when we draft a unified sign code. Because right now we've got 5 different sign codes for different areas of the city, so we'd like to correct that. But just know between now and then, you may see some signs. So this, the main applications we wanted to talk about are site development permits, master site plans, and development agreements. And again, a majority of what you see are site development permits. And they're what we call a level 3 review. And if a project is outside of an urban village and outside of central Issaquah, level 3 reviews are required for projects that either are a level 3 level of review on the table of permitted land uses, which in the land use code are the blue sheets, but also sites that are greater than 3 acres and on a primary street. So that's kind of the determining factor on when something is a level 3 site development permit or not. And I mentioned a community conference a little bit ago. Community conferences are a required step in the site development permit process, again, for projects that are not within central Issaquah. And again, tonight is an example of a project that is on a major street on Sunset Way and went through the community conference process several months ago. And for a level three site development permit, the Development Commission is the decision maker, and it's through a quasi-judicial process, and Amy's going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute. And what you're reviewing there is consistency with the development regulations, the design criteria checklist, or the green sheets in the land use code, and a technical review that of items that are within the land use code. For a master site plan, and those are kind of getting phased out as well, because there are no master site plans either in the urban villages or in central Issaquah. But outside of those areas, if a parcel is greater than 15 acres and is anything other than single family residential, it goes through a master site plan process. And examples of master site plans that you've seen in the last few years, usually it's been schools, like the high school or the middle school, because that whole property is greater than 15 acres. Confluence Park was another example, because that was greater than 15 acres. But there's only a couple of parcels left in the city that could possibly go through a master site plan process. And for those, the Development Commission is not the decision maker, but actually you make a recommendation to the city council. And often, especially in the case with the schools, you'll be reviewing the master site plan concurrently with a site development permit, usually. And for those, a master site plan by itself, the plans are more kind of a site plan. You wouldn't usually see building elevations necessarily, or it's mostly the site plan that you're reviewing for compliance with the comprehensive plan and land use code. And there's specific criteria for master site plans in the code as well. And then development agreements, I think it's been a while since you've seen one, but you may be seeing one at your next meeting for Silverado. But development agreements come to the Development Commission for when a cluster development is proposed, or when a project is utilizing the transfer of development rights, or what we call TDRs. And a cluster development, just by way of explaining, is when there's a residential proposal and they're proposing in a single family zone to either cluster attached units or make smaller lots in an effort to preserve more open space. So we do see those sometimes, and like I said, you may have an example coming up of that. And that too, like master site plans, you're not the decision maker on a development agreement, but instead you're making a recommendation to the city council. So this is just really generally kind of the process that most applications go through, through us and then through you. And this is a site development permit as example. Usually we'll have a kind of an introductory meeting. Sometimes we call it a project feasibility meeting internally, when we go over with the applicant just what the development standards are, what the zoning is, the permitted uses, and just kind of see if what they're proposing will meet the code. And then we will have what we call a collaboration meeting, where they may have some kind of preliminary sketches, some conceptual designs. And in that meeting, we usually have a planner and an engineer, and we kind of share the vision for whatever area they're proposing their project in, and just kind of talk a little bit more about the process. And then the first real application that's made is a pre-application application, and we have a pre-application meeting, and those are plans are starting to get a little more firmed up, at least to the point where we would route it to all of the different permit reviewing departments in the city and kind of gather their comments and share them with the applicant. Again, talk a little bit more about what recommendations we have before they make their larger land use application, and talk a little bit more detail about the process and expectations at that point. So then the actual site development permit submittal, that's the big one. That's the land use permit application. And so we take that in. Again, it's routed to all of the city departments. We notify adjacent property owners and parties of record when the application is submitted. And then subsequently, then we notify them again when the public hearing date is set. And when we set the date for the public hearing, we've compiled all of the comments from all the departments. and the planner drafts a staff report, which includes our overview of the project, description of the project, and then also our recommended conditions. And then it becomes before the Development Commission in a public hearing, which tonight is an example of. And then if the Development Commission approves it or conditionally approves it, we draft a notice of decision. And this goes into a little bit more detail about the steps that you're involved in. As I said, the staff report that the staff writes is sent to you about a week before the hearing. And at the hearing, and there's kind of two parts to it. I mentioned if you're outside of Central Issaquah and it's a site development permit, we will have had a community conference earlier on to give just kind of initial comments and feedback without making any kind of decision. But if it's within Central Issaquah, it's kind of a two-step public hearing process. We'll have the first public hearing where we get your input, get public input, and then we hear whatever issues or concerns that you have. We kind of go back, try to work with the applicant to address those, and draft up what we call a briefing response memo that is kind of an addendum to the staff report addressing those things that came out in that first meeting. And then in the second public hearing portion is when you will see when and how and if we've addressed those things, and at that point you would make your decision on the project. And the reason for the two parts, I know, like I said, when we got rid of the community conference step in Central Issaquah, if we just had one hearing, it would be kind of difficult for you to make your decision and for us to address all of your concerns all in one meeting. So that's why we kind of broken it up, so we have a chance to go back and address your concerns. And then finally, that is, as I said, the staff prepares a notice of decision with the decision and all the conditions, and we prepare that for the chairperson's signature. And that is the approval of a site development permit. And I'll just point out now for all of the, because like I said, there are many different codes and plans and chapters that we use in evaluating projects. And I just wanted to point out that all of those are available on the city's website. And in particular, there's a section called the Document Center on the city's website. And it has, this gives you just an example of where the Central Issaquah plan design standards are. But you can also get to the land use code, the sign code, the critical area ordinance. You can get to all of our codes that we use through there. So I just wanted to make sure you were aware of that. And do you have any particular questions? Yes?
Christopher, is that process, the preceding couple of slides, is that on the website as well, the city's website?
No, not exactly. There's a more detailed flow charts that are part of the land use code.
Okay.
And part of Central Issaquah, but not, this is kind of an abridged version.
Okay, can I suggest that maybe you send, just send copies of the
PowerPoint
to us.
Sure.
Individually, so that, we can always have it, new members can continue to refer to it.
Yeah.
What was that, old guys, was that the reference?
Old-timers?
The old-timers, yeah. So we can refresh our failing memories by looking at it too.
Absolutely.
It would help, I think. Also, I think if you go forward a bit, if you'll notice down the lower left, you need an N on recommendation there.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Anything else?
Question. So the two public hearings that's really taken place, and so the first one would have been called the community conference before. Is there a difference?
Well, there is,
a community,
yeah,
conference and a public hearing?
The difference between them really is that a community conference, the plans are still kind of preliminary, right? They're in the early stages, and so the goal there is to provide your input before they make their more detailed plans. But in the site development permit public hearing for Central Issaquah, the plans are a little bit further along. You know, they're complete basically at that point. But then they may be revised in between those two meetings. But the level of detail on the plans is the big difference.
I had a question.
Yeah.
With respect to tonight's
project, where does it map to this? The last hearing?
Yes, it's basically this one here. Since it's not in Central Issaquah, as I said, there was a community conference that was done for this project a few months ago. And so what we're entering into now won't be a two-part public hearing, it'll just be this one. And this is where you'll be making your decision on the project.
Okay, thank you. Anything else? Okay, Christopher, thank you.
Okay.
I appreciate it. I think this is the kind of thing that from time to time we need to do.
It's good to back up and...
Yeah, and it also helps to have this in the public portion of it too, so people have the opportunity to understand what the process is.
Exactly. And now Amy's going to talk a little bit about the quasi-judicial aspect of it.
Okay. Thank you, Christopher. So I think Christopher had already touched on your role as a development commission. So I am going to skip along to the next slide. So basically, just a very brief description of what quasi-judicial mean. In this particular instance, basically the process is like a court. Basically, you serve almost like a court. And the proceedings have to be fair and appear to be fair. And there are two aspects of your role and your responsibilities are focused on. One is the procedural due process, and then the other one is the substantive due process. So in both cases, both situations have to be met. So for procedural due process, we look at whether we followed all the steps that's required by law. And also, basically, there's a focus on your role with the person who's benefiting from the decision, which is the applicant. For substantive due process, basically we look at the adopted regulations, you know, whether or not staff established that the project met the standards, and also that conditions that we recommend and that you eventually accept and use for the approval is reasonable and related to alleviating a problem created by the project. So this is where we talk a lot about nexus and proportionality. So for tonight's public hearing, we go through this exercise for the new members. Basically, we have these six questions that we ask everyone to evaluate on your own. I'm not going to read all of them, but I'll give you time to kind of look through them, and then at the end, I'm just going to check and see where everyone's at. So hopefully everyone's done. Looks like you guys are looking at me, which means you read a lot faster than me. Is there anyone in the commission that would answer yes to any of these questions? Okay, that's great. And we're good. So the other aspect that we'd like to kind of just touch on is about ex parte communications between the applicant and the commission. So ex parte means that you had, for whatever reason, contact with the applicant and discussed the project, and somehow that influenced your decision tonight. So if ex parte contacts have occurred, the question is, has any one of you been involved in that for this particular project?
I have a question on that, Amy. So if a member of the public recognizes that one of us is a member of the Development Commission and speaks to us about a specific project, either positively or negatively, is that considered, because it says a decision maker and an opponent or proponent, so does that cover conversations in the Isle of Safeway between somebody that is really has a strong position on it, whether they know the details or not, and a member of the Development Commission.
So I am not that sophisticated. I don't know, Christopher, do you have an answer to that?
I know the safest thing to do is to announce the, in this forum, announce what that conversation included, and then ask if anybody thinks there's a reason to question that or excuse yourself.
Okay.
And I thought part of the training said that the idea, too, is to bring that issue up and gives the developer or the applicant a chance to respond to that question at the meeting itself.
And so that everybody yeah. has the same information when they're making the decision.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks for that question. And
yeah, I just will say that I have been on the receiving end of that, which I am fine with. One of the reasons that I haven't brought it up to now is that I have yet to hear substantive arguments from the person addressing me. It's just it's an ideological thing or, you know, a philosophical thing about the nature of the community, not a specific thing about it's not in compliance with this code or that code. Those comments have all been inside this room, but you know, I have been addressed by a number of people who are expressing an opinion about development. So,
what about this project?
No, not
so,
about this.
So, in other words, like for instance,
not this project.
Exactly. In other words, like they would maybe bring up how traffic is an issue in the community. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I think from a practical standpoint, if you're living in Issaquah right now, it's hard not to run into somebody that has an opinion about traffic.
I agree. Yeah.
Or development. But
or crime.
It's very rare that somebody would bring up details of a particular project other than I have heard people say they aren't too happy about colors of certain new buildings that are going in. But I think that's just a reality of living in Issaquah right now.
I agree. But I just want to be really clear for
sure.
all of us that if it's at that level, it's not about a specific, it's not about a perceived or question or comment on compliance or plan, following plans, something that's out of that. It's not covered by this. We don't have to worry about it. If it's
yes,
just
this is
comment.
Specific to the project.
Okay.
To your, in whatever ways could affect your making a decision and back to the appearance of fairness. So I think we're done with this, right? No one had any ex parte communication. Great. So now I'm going to proceed and to the next item in our agenda. And this is the, wrong one. And this is the Sunset 7 apartment site development permit. So first of all, I'd like to make a note that I am submitting Exhibit 1 as part of the record. This is a comment received from a resident and through email, and I've responded to her questions about timing for approval. And each of you receive a copy of Exhibit 1 as well. So for tonight's presentation, hopefully I'll do this very quickly. I have basically this three steps. I'll start with existing conditions and the context and talk about briefly the compliance to the comprehensive plan and then the compliance to the development standards. So under development standards, that's when I'll get into a more detailed discussion about the zoning and the multifamily development criteria. So as Christopher had mentioned earlier, for projects in the main parts of the city under the IMC, we basically have a two-step process. So this project actually was presented to the Development Commission on November 18. 2015 for a community conference. And at the time, we received several comments and questions. And so tonight's presentation will focus on responding to a lot of those questions and comments from that community conference. So just quickly, the proposal is for three floors of residential over a ground floor garage with 7 residential units and 14 parking spaces. So this is a view from Sunset Way of this multifamily project. This one shows kind of a composite of the site plan and the landscape plan. I superimposed it so you get to see a little bit more of the treatment of the yard. So the building is actually set in the middle of the property and set back from the sidewalk along Sunset Way by 10 feet. And then for the side yards, there is a setback of about 17 feet. And the rear yard is set back about 20 feet. So the main building entry and loading will be along Sunset Way. Right here, you see the entrance to the building. So here's the sidewalk. It's a little, the lines are a little faded, but basically this is the walkway to get to the main lobby. The elevators are over here, stairs, and another door to the garage. There's also street trees that are proposed, and consistent with the way the other multifamily developments are treated along Sunset Way, the street trees are actually behind the sidewalk instead of between the roadway and the sidewalk. So vicinity map, this shows the project site. This is actually the in the Old Town sub-district of the city. And what you see here is the different zoning districts related to where we are. So the project is in the multifamily high-density zoning, again, sub-district of the Old Town. And along and immediately west, at the end of Sunset Way, is the CBD, or Cultural Business District, that's in the dark color areas. And anything that's white is a single family duplex. So everything across the alley from this property is zoned single family duplex. And there's some single family small lots further in the perimeter of the area. So existing land uses, again, zooming further in into the property. We see that most of the uses south of Sunset are residential. Both single family and multifamily. And then on the north, you see more commercial uses. Again, now looking at the area from the street view, to the left is the property, the project site. And this is looking towards the CBD. So across the street is a two-story office building. And along this corridor, you see a mix of one-story to four-story buildings. And you can see one of the four-story multifamily buildings, just two lots west of this project. Sunset Way currently is a two-lane roadway, one way each way. And the sidewalk is flush to the grade, no curbs and gutters. And there's on-street parking on what looks like a shoulder, a road shoulder. Another view, this time looking straight at the property. Currently, there's an existing single-family house on the site. No significant trees, and basically the whole site has been developed as a yard. And now looking at the same property at the rear, this is an alley from which currently the project site access is off for vehicular access. Again, this shows you the single family structure on the site with a carport. So there's no existing driveway. I guess they just drive over the grass. This alley is also a service alley for all the properties. So you do see along the alley when you drive, you know, they do have their trash receptacles sitting out at the edge of the alley. And the alley is actually 20 feet wide, but the paving itself is not completely for the whole 20 feet right now. So a review of what I presented at the last community conference, this property is actually in what's considered the East Sunset Way development area of this, of Old Town. So there are some key principles that we use to guide our review of this project. And I'm not going to go through all of them. And basically, I'm just going to highlight that the idea that this is meant to be a transition area from the low-scale single family to the more commercial parts of, the Old Town area. And also that we're looking for a pedestrian-friendly streetscape. So just a quick review of the development standards. I'm not going to go through everything, but just to kind of identify on the left column, and this is all in your staff in the staff report. On the left column is the standards, the city standards, and on the right is what they're proposing. So you see right away that they do meet the standards, and for the building height, the applicant has requested an administrative adjustment of height standards, which is provided for in the land use code, as long as they meet all the criteria. So proposing for the building height to go up to 46 feet, 6 inches from 40 feet. And we have reviewed their administrative adjustment of standards and has approved it. And I'm going to kind of like quickly just do a little review later on about that. So again, for setbacks, pretty much it shows these are minimums. So they are, like what I said earlier, the side yard setbacks are between 16 and a half and 17 and a half feet. So as I mentioned, in our review of the administrative adjustment of height standards, we have included one condition of approval, and this is in line with some of the public comments last time regarding the elevator tower at the corner. We clarified that the tower itself is not subject to the height standards because there's a list of exceptions in the land use code. However, we have required this as a condition for the criteria regarding creating a more pedestrian scale along Sunset Way. So the condition basically requires them to add some additional articulation for this corner to, again, treat the scale or to soften the scale. So one of the items that was discussed at length at the last community conference is what's the vision for Sunset Way. So we're coming back today to kind of give the commission more information about that. So Sunset Way, as I mentioned last time, was categorized as a minor arterial. And we do have current street standards for a minor arterial, not quite what you see there today. As you can see, for a minor arterial, there's supposed to be two lanes, a total of four lanes, basically two lanes each way, with a 5-foot bike lane on both sides, and a 5-foot planter strip, and then between 5 to 12 feet of sidewalk. So one thing you notice here is that it doesn't have any provision for on-street parking, which is what we have today. So we're going to take this as information, and we're going to put this aside because in this case, there are a lot of standards and policies and visions that guide what we want Sunset Way to be. And one of the things that we also have to consider is that there's an evolution to how the community has viewed Sunset Way through the years. So this was obviously adopted for, you know, I don't know, a decade ago as a standard. So since then, you've heard of the walk and roll study, and the information from the walk and roll study has been used to basically inform the city's comprehensive plan transportation element. And in that, in the transportation element, Sunset Way was identified as a future corridor for separated bike lane. So this is just an example of what a separated bike lane is. We don't know at this stage exactly how this will fit into the existing 60-foot right-of-way of Sunset Way. And there are obviously, and some of you may have even heard of this, but there has been community input and discussion about whether or not to keep or to replace the on-street parking on Sunset Way. We, as staff, do not have any recommendations or clear direction from, you know, from you know, further above as to what exactly this is going to be at this time. So having said that, we also have this bigger context that we have to consider, which is, again, something that is a current initiative, and this has to do with this fall ballot measure for transportation project funding. So some of you may have heard that City Council had decided to add East Sunset Way for consideration. They haven't made a final decision, but for consideration in this packet of potential projects for the November ballot. So they're planning to make a vote on the final list on July 18th. And so we're kind of ahead of them. And so we had to factor that into our recommendation, we as in staff, in our recommendation for this project for tonight. And in the meantime, City Council also directed staff to prepare a conceptual design for Sunset Way with all those, with the considerations that I just mentioned earlier.
Excuse me. All right. If you go back two slides real quick, I apologize. One more. You said 60 feet right away that you have so far for Sunset Way, and then just doing the simple math, the minimums there, that's 74 feet.
Yes. So basically, it doesn't mean that you have to have two lanes of traffic. In fact, based on what's out there today, chances are it's going to remain as a two-lane roadway with more pedestrian and bike amenities. And again, that's more of just sensing from the direction of what the community wants out of Sunset Way.
Can you tell us what I don't know what the proposed project on East Sunset Way was. Do you know what that is? Is that to develop a minor arterial?
You mean this one here?
Yeah.
So City Council doesn't know either what that would look like. That's why they're asking staff to come up with some kind of, at least even at the very, very preliminary conceptual stage, you know, something that. So with that, one of the recommendation for this project, condition 10 in the staff report, is for the applicant to pay a fee in lieu for the street frontage improvements. Again, this has to do with the fact that timing-wise, because we don't know what Sunset Way is going to look like, then we can't really ask them to build their half-street improvements. And basically, it just goes through the details of what that would entail. And staff has also gotten new information from our Public Works Engineering Director. As a clarification, this project does not qualify for a traffic impact fee credit because the Sunset Way corridor is not part of our TIP. So only projects, and you probably heard this also before, that, you know, only projects that are in the transportation impact I'm sorry, transportation improvement projects or plan is eligible for impact fee credits.
Amy, I think that has the wrong title on it, does it not?
Where?
Newport as opposed to Sunset.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I was talking to someone who had another. Thank you very much. Yes. So now I'm going to walk through the multi-development standards. Again, this is under the IMC for multifamily developments. We have specific criteria. It kind of overlaps the general standards. So for this project, we actually reviewed, even for the design standards, we used the multifamily development standards in the Old Town design standards instead of the green sheet. So for tonight, when you review this project later on for consideration, I know you're used to using the green sheet. I would recommend that you look in the staff report at the end. I have a table there for basically the multifamily development design standards. This is where I want to start also focusing on some of the public comments and other Development Commission questions from the last community conference. So this is not comprehensive. The staff report covers all the design standards and criteria for multifamily standards. So regarding site access and circulation, we had questions about what happens to the bike lane on Sunset Way, what happens to the alley access for this site. So these little symbols just show that Sunset Way is primarily for pedestrian and for bike access. So I already touched on the fact that Sunset Way is part of the transportation element and designated for a future bicycle lane. And as far as for vehicular access, basically similar to the other multifamily developments along Sunset Way and other properties, even the single family ones, access for the vehicular for vehicles is on the alley side. As far as the alley, one of the things that we are recommending as a condition, again, I mentioned earlier the condition of the alley, is that the applicant will be required to repave the whole 20-foot width of the right-of-way. And starting from basically 4th Place Southeast, which is the road, all the way to the interior of their lot, up to the western edge of their property. Another criteria had to do with building modulation and roof modulation. So one of the concerns last time was the scale of this building, especially with the single-family homes across the alley. So this was the same presentation I gave last time, and just the box represents the height of what's allowed for by the zoning for a single family duplex. Our current standards require for buildings abutting a higher density building, abutting a lower density building, that there are additional setback requirements and cascading and resetting back of the building height as you go further up. So that's what they've done here. There were also questions about visitor parking and loading. This is the existing condition there today. Like I mentioned earlier, there's a shoulder and cars just park on the shoulder. So that will remain the same for this project. As far as for moving trucks, they will be parking on Sunset. And as I showed earlier, the elevator lobby is closer to Sunset Way, so it's a very convenient access for moving trucks or for movers, and also for visitor parking. Private and common usable outdoor space. So this is just to show you how they met the standards. There's really no specific conditions we're recommending. So on the left, it shows how each of the unit, this is just typical, but each of the unit will have its own balconies, and the balconies are a little bigger than what's required by code. On the right, it shows also common usable open space. On the left, it shows a lawn, and on the right, it shows a pea patch. And this is the alley over here and Sunset Way over here. Another question has to do with the screening of the garage. So currently, their concept shows grills on the garage openings, and we have, and they're also providing vegetation, including trees and shrubberies on both sides. And along the alley side, they're showing a low wall with some shrubs. And so this car, it kind of shows you this car is turning into the garage entrance. The one thing that is missing is you don't see any screening on the southwest corner of the rear yard. So we have three conditions related to screening of the garage. Condition three basically talks about garage openings are required to be decorative. They can't be just vertical bars, which is what is shown today. Condition four talks about making sure that the existing one car parking space that's outside of the garage is screened from view of the residences across the alley, and also providing additional screening for the southwest corner, so that by the time they meet condition four and six, the only part of their rear yard that will be visible is the opening for the driveway from across the alley. Other questions about, and this was actually a comment by the Development Commission last time. They know that, you guys noted that on the elevation facing south, there was a lost opportunity with not having any windows. So this was the elevation shown to you last time. And so they have addressed, and this was a lost opportunity of being able to see the mountains, the hillsides on the other, across the property. So they have added large and numerous windows on all the upper floors. The other question that the Development Commission asked was, how do we define the primary views, which is one of the design standards? So I went back and researched this a little bit more, and this is actually the wording in the design standards. So it gives you the impression that, especially when it talks about Rainier Boulevard and the railroad right-of-way pathway, it seems to be talking more about a corridor that's public, that's publicly accessible. And then secondly, in looking at how other multifamily developments along Sunset Way were developed, it informed us that we're not really talking about the view from across the street looking towards this way, but rather along the corridor. So in using that as a guide, they are maintaining the view corridor since their right of way is further out. I'm sorry, their building is stepped back a little bit, and none of the building is obstructing any of our scenic views. So based on that, staff and the administration recommends that the Development Commission move to approve the site development permit for Sunset 7 Apartments, SDP 16-00004, with plans, architectural drawings, and technical studies submitted on April 21, 2016, the staff report dated July 6, 2016, with attachments 1 through 7, Exhibit 1 and the staff recommended conditions of approval with revision to condition 10 to delete the second paragraph. I know this is a mouthful. Secondly, direct the Development Services Department to prepare the findings of fact and conclusions for review and approval by the Development Commission Chairman, affirming the Development Commission's decision to approve the site development permit for Sunset 7 Apartments, SDP 16-00004, based on plans, architectural drawings, and technical studies submitted on April 21st, 2016, the staff report dated July 6, 2016, with attachments 1 through 7, Exhibit 1, and conditions of approval as adopted or amended if applicable by the Development Commission on July 6, 2016. The staff analysis and conclusions in the staff report shall serve as the findings of fact. That concludes my presentation. I'm open for questions.
Okay. Are there questions, requests for clarifications, or anything from members of the commission for Amy?
Well, I'd like to clarify on Sunset Way. So if the city votes for the road improvements, we'll get that design in front of this new development, whatever that design
yes.
is.
Yes, whatever the future.
And the concurrency fees collected will go from this development will go into that project?
Actually, it's three pots of,
work?
It's three different pots. So yeah. The traffic impact fees go to our system-wide transportation projects, which may not even include the Sunset Way. Yeah. And then their frontage improvements, it's what's required for every project. And normally they would just build it, but in this case, because we don't know what to ask them to build, then we're requiring a fee in lieu. And then the third pot, and I don't know if you remember this, but there are SEPA mitigation fees for both pedestrian and bike facilities. So again, that's a different pot. So that's also why we can't give them credit for any, because they're all three different pots.
Now, if the traffic measure doesn't pass, would there have to be another go back with the developer on what the design or the frontage improvements would look like, or is that?
I think at this point, what we're saying is we also want to provide them with predictability. So yeah. The fee in lieu would suffice, and they can move forward with their project, and they're not going to have to build anything if they fulfill their fee in lieu.
Okay.
Eventually, I think there is enough interest in Sunset Way that we will. It's just more of a timing issue. We don't know exactly when we'll have something decided on the design.
Okay.
Other than the developer wants a dirt lot without a sidewalk in front of their place for 6 months, a year, or 2 years, depending on what the timing of the new Sunset plan is, though, either.
I'm sorry.
If they're not going to build a sidewalk, if they're not going to build the frontage to it, and it takes 6 months or a year or 2 years for us to decide what's going to happen with Sunset Way, is that going to just remain dirt up there, or?
Oh, okay. So actually, currently there is an existing sidewalk. It in front of their property, it also looks like this, and I can scroll back. See, there's an existing sidewalk, and then there's also the existing shoulder. It's just not our, it doesn't meet our current standards.
Anything else?
So, Chairman, how much are we talking about? That's the first question I guess everybody would be interested in, especially the developer. And then the second question is that the fee that's being put in this pot it's supposed to be going to the construction of the sidewalk, and it may not. So how do we go about that? Is it fair for the developer?
So, so to answer your question, how much?
Mm-hmm.
It's based on the design mm-hmm. of a half street minor arterial improvement. So the actual details will be determined during their construction permit. They would have to provide us with designs, basically, you know, construction drawings that show this is what that's going to look like, and with a cost estimate of what that entails. And that's going to be their fee in lieu.
Okay, well, Mr. Chairman, can I go into the plans and have some questions sure. about the clarification of it? First of all, thanks for the presentation, Amy. I wasn't here in November for the first go-around, and I thought, looking at it, you know, it's a very nice set of drawings, very detailed. But I have a few questions. On the parking level A2.2, there's a workshop. What is that for? Do you know?
Do you guys want to answer that? Well, I can quickly answer. So so one of the things that we require is that the users along Sunset Way have to be pedestrian friendly. Mm-hmm. So originally they actually showed the garage there. So we were able to work it out with them so that it becomes more of a resident amenity. As far as exactly whether it's going to be a tool shed or a craft shop for, you know, depends on who the residents are going to be.
For the residents?
Yes, it's for the residents.
Oh, I see. And it's got windows, so.
Yeah, so that, yeah, again.
The
so
public is not invited,
no.
Is that correct?
No, yeah.
Okay. And then another comment that I have is that, again, on the same sheet, on the same area, you have the bicycle parking, which is located next to the workshop, yet the bicycle entrance is on the south side of the building. Not a major issue, but it's just that you're entering from the south end of the building, you got to walk all the way to the front, almost to the north end of the building, and that's where you park your bike.
So I actually must have misunderstood that, because in our minds, because the bike lane is along Sunset Way, mm-hmm. then chances are, if you're on a bike, if you're a resident, you're going to come in through the lobby. The bike rack is something that can be moved around, so we can work that out with the applicant.
Mm-hmm. Okay, the other thing is that garbage pickup. I take it when garbage is being picked up on the alley side of the property?
Right.
And I guess somebody's going to move all those garbage cans onto the side of the alley for the garbage truck to pick up.
Right.
And is that going to be on the west, southwest, on the south property, on the west side of the
So
property?
we thought that that's an important, let me see if I have, okay, there. So one of the neighbors actually did this. They intentionally have a little, you know, what I would call an alcove, where they place their their waste collection bins. So we've actually asked them, condition 9, that they also provide some sort of a pad, you know, an area by the backyard where during days when trash collection is due, that they would be able to pull their bins out. So they're not sitting out in the alley
mm-hmm.
itself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's one of the conditions.
Mm-hmm. And I take it it's probably on the west side of the south property line then.
Let's see. So west side, you mean here?
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
Whose responsibility is it to take out the trash cans? I mean, that's the curiosity I had. Since there's so many of them, is it the residents? Is it someone who works for the city? I mean, how the trash cans get outside? They don't magically walk out?
Do you have an answer to that, DJ? Basically, it's the residents. It's a small apartment.
It's more of an operational. And the other thing is, on your second...
I'm sorry, can we follow up on the trash cans?
Sure.
Before we go past that, if that's okay, Mr. Chair?
Sure.
Just You mentioned a pad out there, but they're right at 50% for the pervious impervious, so they can't do any more impervious. So it's, I was trying to figure out when you had this condition in or had a separate area, could they put impervious pavers in there and had that count as pervious still, or? You mentioned a pad, but they can't really do a pad because that would put them below the standard.
And I appreciate you bringing that up. So they're pea patch right now. They are proposing wood chips. And that was their way around meeting their 50% impervious because, you know, in some cases, some people usually use gravel for, and so that by them using wood chips, then it's still considered pervious. And so I'm kind of thinking that whatever that pad is going to be, it's going to be something that's pervious also.
Okay.
Yeah.
Commissioner Long, did you have another?
Another one. On the stair, on 3.2, I like the window that's around the staircase, stairwell. But just a clarification, on the second floor, on your southwest stairwell, you're gonna have windows in there. Is that correct? Or is that a, I think it's a drafting error?
I think the stairs that you're looking at that's on the southwest, it's really for fire. That's their egress.
Yeah, but the wall.
Yeah, I'm looking.
The wall that you have there. On the A3.2?
Yeah, so they are showing, if you look at A4.4, the west elevation. Is that correct, the way you guys have represented that?
It may not have just shown up on the plan, but whatever the elevation.
If somebody's going to comment, I'd ask you to come up and identify yourself.
Do you have this slide?
Which sheet? 4.2.
On A3.2.
Yeah, well,
second
good
floor.
Yeah, that's the elevation. Version I have.
Right. So I guess, first of all, my name is Reed Geck from GMS Architectural Group, for the record. Graphically, it is probably just the cut line was too low for that to show, but there is a window in that stair on 3.2, the second floor.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the cut line was a little higher than what is shown. But graphically, if you look at the elevation, it is there.
So this mm-hmm. is correct.
Yeah. The elevations are correct. It just may not have shown up on the plan.
Okay.
That answers
similar to third floor.
Correct. So there will be windows going all the way up wherever we can get them in that stairwell.
Okay. Got you. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
I have a question on color. I noticed in the packet that we came in on the color palette was identified as primarily grays with a red accent. And I just want to confirm, from the reading through it and looking at this, I got the impression that the red, in fact, is going to be in the garage screens?
Just in the metal grates to the ventilation.
Metal grates, right. So that's where the red is going to be. It's not a paint or something like that, accent point on the modulations.
No, it'll be powder-coated.
Okay.
And that
just an accent to give an accent.
Yeah, and that's visible from the sunset frontage or the backside.
There will be two in the front that you will see from sunset.
Okay.
So could I build on that question? There was one condition in the checklist I noticed for architectural grills that that blocked the screening. Was there a detail provided?
Not at this point, no. We don't have a detail for that.
Okay. But generally, they'll be red of some decorative nature.
Right, exactly.
Okay. And that was a condition that they couldn't have just vertical bars. It had to have the, whatever the element was there, had to be decorative in nature, yeah, as well as security.
Right.
Okay. Are there any other questions, clarifications by members of the commission?
There was one other condition about lighting. Is there a lighting plan provided about for landscape lighting and bollards?
So often with projects that are small like this, unless there's like where lighting is a major part of their design function, we usually review that during the construction permit.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Anything else?
And just a clarification for the newer members of the commission. What's interesting is that in the land use code, lighting is not required. The lighting standard only applies when an applicant actually chooses to use exterior lighting.
Okay. If there are no further clarifications or comments at this point by the members of the commission, we will open it to members of the public who care to speak. Again, I would ask you, in addition to signing in, if you come up before you you give yourself, give your name and your address, please. Let me ask you something before we do that. Did the applicant have, did you have an presentation that you wanted to make? Okay, all right. In that case, we'll go to public comment.
Hello, am I standing in the right position here? Okay, my name is Denise Coghlan. I live at 295 East Sunset Way, 10 feet from the project. Looks like a beautiful project, and I want to express concerns that I have come have experienced since I learned about the project and the speed at which it is going through. And I don't know that this is relevant in any way to your decision making. I just want to speak as a member of the public, a renter, and a resident of Issaquah. I've come across several situations of how your planning commission does business and notification that has some very, very difficult implications for tenants in the vicinity of a project. I'm going to give you a quick synopsis of my personal situation. First of all, most of us do not enjoy being tenants. We'd much rather own. I had a personal, serious personal emergency in my life that altered its trajectory. Thus, I find myself renting. Since the Great Recession, the housing market is very, very difficult, both for buyers and renters. I was in a townhouse in Shoreline for 9 years, and I commuted to Issaquah for 3.5 years because of a wonderful job situation. Last August, I was given 30 days notice to vacate after 9 years by my landlord who lived next door. They had three families have to vacate a very large townhouse building with three units. It impacted us quite seriously. You'd have to use your imagination to pretend you went home and got an email tonight that said you have 30 days to move your residence of 9 years. It was excruciating. I had to spend over $5,000 for the move, some of which was a loan. When I looked at the apartment where I am now, I asked the landlord about the vacant property next door. And I said, any chance they're going to be building soon? I had concerns. He said, oh, no. The person who bought it is going to hold it as a land trust until he can purchase the additional houses, to the end of the block. So my intent was to try to keep an eye on that and find out if anything was going to change, both for two personal health reasons and because I have a companion animal with a heart condition. And the noise would probably be the last straw. My health condition would also force me to move. And if I waited to see the impact and had to break my tenancy lease, then I would be possibly sued by my landlord. So what I found out in your process is that the hearing in November, notification went out to property owners. When I inquired why apartment dwellers were not informed, I was told the letter included a request to please tell their friends and family. I don't know if any of you are landlords or have worked with landlords. I have personally had a good landlord in the past, but it's a business. I would have appreciated some integrity on the part of my landlord, which was not forthcoming. So he has known since last November this was coming. I didn't see the final writing on the wall until the sign went up, and I really scrambled to find out, because I was going to do more inquiry before my lease was up at the end of the summer. The way my landlord handled the situation was to say nothing and then send a non-legal form to all of us to sign by July 1st with a rent increase. And the form was to make his life easier so that our leases would now run until July 31st of every year. When I did not comply with that agreement, he called me from the Caribbean and put undue pressure on me to find out why I didn't sign his form. I told him I will be moving because of the construction, noise, dust, and other impacts on my life, even though I have just spent $5,000 to get settled here. He tried to make me a deal to rent the apartment before I moved, and so that, you know, and he encouraged me how not to discuss the construction next door, pretty much buyer beware. And that's true, you know. Had I not had 30 days from my 9-year tenancy, I really would not have had to rush into a situation so vulnerable. So I own that. But by not making your process require notification of adjacent tenants, you have left out a very, very important piece of the puzzle and has serious consequences. I further inquired about the construction hours and was told Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. to 6 p.m., and I can already tell you right now, when the double gravel trucks, dump trucks, come barreling down Sunset Way, it rattles all the way through the unit where I live, which was, I also discussed with my landlord, how is the noise on East Sunset Way? Oh, not bad. There's traffic during rush hour. So beware, you know, landlords don't necessarily tell the truth. So then I was told that they could also get a permit to work 9 to 5 off hours on Saturdays. I had to continue to think of every question I could to get all the answers I was looking for. They were not forthcoming via email. So what I was told was that you have surveyed the region to see what other jurisdictions have in terms of construction hours during weekends and found out that this is standard to allow construction on Saturdays. As a philosophy major, I will tell you that historical behavior is not a truth. It's a fallacy to say, therefore, this is the right thing to do. Maybe you were not trying to tell me that. But imagine yourself working full-time and spending 44% of your income to pay rent. And now you find out that from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. every day, Monday through Friday, it could be unending noise. And on Saturday, should the builder get the extra permit, it will start at 9. Wonderful. So we are to live 6 days a week with unending noise and work to pay 44% of our income for shelter? It left me wondering who benefits. Certainly the city of Issaquah will benefit for the tax base of this unit. The builder will benefit to be done sooner, to rent the luxury units and make money. I realize I have friends that are builders. I know how much interest goes out for the construction loan. But where in this picture does anyone think about people, non-builders, non-property owners, tenants who are Issaquah residents, who shop in Issaquah? These are all the stores I frequent in Issaquah. I thought, doesn't matter. Do I contact each of them? Say bye, I've enjoyed working with you, but this town is not friendly to people like me? I'm urging you to rethink how you do business, how you approve projects, why you allow 6 days a week of unending construction noise. Maybe you need to look at that also on a day-to-day basis and site to site. Nowhere in all of this has the applicant been required to put any kind of retaining wall to deal with the noise issues that are gonna incur from the moment it gets approved, which could be tonight because they were pre-approved and people like me didn't know about it, until it's done in July of 2017 or however long it's delayed. So that is my personal experience. It's a living hell, and I really hope you think about the impact on everyone. I see you're putting in another 900 rental units, I think, in Issaquah. God knows we need rental units. But heaven help you if you allow something like this 6 days a week next to 900 units coming up. You are going to have some feedback. I'm just one very, very distraught human being that has to spend my next 6 weeks and everything I can muster financially leaving so that I don't get sick from the 6 day a week construction that is impending. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak?
I have to get up first. So it happens when you get old and you have a kneecap replacement. You have a hard time walking.
Before I start with Issaquah, my name is Joanne Van Dersen and I live in Issaquah. I'm not gonna give you my address. I had a couple of comments to make to this person that's the renter. I lived in West Seattle when the bridge busted down, in case you people don't remember that. That man at the end might, 78 to 86. And regarding the noise factor, they got special permits to do the concrete pile driving 6 days a week from 6 in the morning to 10 o'clock at night. I was within about 2 miles for 6 days a week hearing steel against steel, slam, slam, slam. I moved out of West Seattle and I moved to the South End. And speaking of not being told about construction, there was a 50-acre woods right next to where I bought a home. It could have been a pup tent, it could have been a mobile trailer, but it was what I could afford. Nobody told me either that there was, quote, zoning for a school. Oh no, we don't tell that to anybody. I happened to be there probably about 2 or 3 years. And lo and behold, here comes the tree removals. Kind of like Jarvis up here, the moonscape that they're calling it, the Jarvis slaughter. I think they're going to add about 400 cars to that street. Of course, we don't widen streets, we just pour more cars on them. So they took all the trees out in the south end, right next to me, and it happened to be a manufactured housing. The shaking, rattling, and rolling of the machinery that ripped out these trees also ruined all of the manufactured houses. And were the people told there? No, nothing, zero. That is what you people who are sitting behind those desks making these decisions need to do. Inform the public. I happen to have been 5 months where I was not able to get out of my condominium. How I became interested in what's going on here is because I saw that reader board sign. I saw the article in the paper. One of the things that the person said, I thought I'd have this built by now. No, you won't. This is Issaquah, we're not Bellevue. We don't want to look like Bellevue. We want to look like Issaquah. 14 parking spaces are the minimum. All along, in your presentation, you've never pointed out where you're going to have the handicapped parking. Two of them are required. Two of them. One inside the garage, one outside. I happen to be a handicapped person, and I'm well familiar with those placards. That's never been mentioned. Next thing I noticed, this is number 3. What is the plan for overflow parking? You got 14 minimum spaces. Okay, 7 units, 2 spaces for every unit. What's gonna happen to your 3-bedroom when your cars decide to overflow? Are we gonna hang them from the trees? You might have 4 cars in those 3 bedrooms. My opinion, when I first saw this in the Issaquah paper, it's too big for that lot. What about the shadow effect? Such as the building putting a shadow on somebody's house? What about the 24-hour noise, like that lady mentioned? Rumble, rattle, cars coming and going all the time. Last one, why did the developer pick Issaquah for the building? Why not stay in Bellevue? I assume the article said the owner was from Bellevue, so why not stay in Bellevue? You can build skyscrapers in Bellevue. We don't want skyscrapers here. I happen to like living here. I've been here 15 years.
I believe the owner's been in Issaquah for 65 years.
All right, let's keep the emotional levels, please, down.
I'm making my comments, okay?
Ma'am, if you need to speak, you will be given an opportunity to answer any specific questions or clarifications. And ma'am, I understand that you're upset about
but we need to keep
this at a civil level, please.
I'm almost finished. And to the person who made the remark, building color, I'm Gilman, quote, just a fact of living in Issaquah, I know what you're referring to. The apartment down on Gilman. I go to the bank down there. Those ladies in that bank have lost the entire view of the mountains. They have to run their lighting all the time, and their views have completely been taken away. So those are my remarks. I have nothing else to say.
Thank you very much.
Now, if anybody has anything that they want to say to me,
All right. So I have one question of staff, and that is, at what date did this application become public knowledge? Public knowledge in that accessing the city website, talking to staff, whatever, would have provided the information regarding the application and the plan. I just want to get it read into the record, Amy, at this point.
So the notice of application was...
Microphone.
The notice of application was mailed out on June 24th, 2016. It was made available to the general public through our website within that same week, and then also the site sign was installed within the next 2 weeks, 2 to 3 weeks.
Okay.
Can I ask just a question on that? When we did the community conference in November, was that publicly noticed?
Yes, but... at that time, they're not required to put a site sign. Yes.
Okay.
Are there any questions, clarifications, before we go to the next step?
Just one question. The question about number of handicap stalls.
So we have already made some initial review of that, and so the handicap stall is actually here. And it's for a van, and this is the refuge that's required for that. I will have to double check with our building official as far as whether it needs to, because I think we kind of talked about this, and they didn't really bring up two, but I'll double check. And again, for ADA parking, that's usually required as part of the building permit review, not at the land use level. So we didn't really touch on that in the staff report.
But it is a requirement.
Yes. They're definitely required to meet all the ADA, the federal ADA standards.
Mr. Chair, another quick question.
Mr. Brennan.
Just related to the noticing, just for clarification for the commission and the public. What is the noticing process for these projects for a site development permit that the city goes through to notify the public about a project?
So as far as mailing the notices, we rely on the King County Assessor's Office's addresses. So obviously that's why we basically reach the property owners, and in cases where you have rental properties, we have actually considered what are some ways that we could potentially contact renters, but it's because we don't know who they are, we don't know how to send out the notices. And so we decided to be safe, because otherwise there was a big chance that we will miss some and send out some, and so we really couldn't find a reliable way of notifying renters and other people in the neighborhood. You know, for instance, for people who live outside of the 300 feet, right? Because the legal requirement is to basically provide notice for property owners within the 300 feet. So one of our, obviously not a perfect solution, was to, in the notice of application, we do have a little paragraph there that says, please share this information with anyone in the community who may be interested in this project.
Are there also publications in newspapers or websites in other locations?
I could talk about that. So within basically the first month of the application being complete, we do make mail out the notice of application to adjacent property owners.
Christopher, I think you have to.
So within a month of the application being deemed complete, we send out the notice of application to adjacent property owners, like Amy said, based on the ownership information we get from the King County Assessor's Office. Also within that time period, the proposed land use action sign is required to be put up on the site. And also at that time, the project is posted on the city's website in both an active projects list and an active projects map. And sometimes we'll know the date of the public hearing at the time we send that out, and if we do, we notify them of the date for the public hearing. But if we don't, which we often don't, we send out another notice that's required to go out at least 10 days prior to the public hearing that public hearing is happening. Mm-hmm. And then also for that public hearing, notice is put into the newspaper at least 2 weeks in advance.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Christopher and Amy, we have heard a number of members of the public who have come before the Development Commission in the last year who have referred to information they were provided either by their landlord or by their realtor. And would you just, for the record again, there is, as I understand it, there is no code or law that requires realtors or landlords, property owners, to notify tenants of coming changes to adjacent property or to their own property within a specified period of time. Is that, and that would be a, would that be a state law or a county?
All I can say is there's nothing within the city regulations that require anything like that. So whether there's state requirements or realtor requirements, I don't know, but nothing that we enforce or regulate.
Okay,
right. Mr. Chair, can I add something? Sure. I guess I would want to say, Amy, the language that you had about any interested parties from landlords, might be nice to say, especially any tenants of buildings on the property. Very helpful.
We can certainly do that.
I think that would be a good idea. Because the intent of it is to let people that will be affected by it know of it in time to review it, participate in public meetings, and so on. So I think that would be a good thing.
Okay.
Yeah, Mr. Chair. Question, the 300 feet, where do you start measuring 300 feet?
It's from the property lines. So it's from the exterior boundaries of the parcel.
That's where you measure.
Right.
So if it touches another property within that 299 feet,
yeah, if that three from the exterior boundaries of the property, if it touches even just a little bit of a corner, it's automatically included in the mailing list.
Okay, yeah. And I think it's fair that, you know, you do diligence in contacting the city, I mean, the assessor's office. That's where the record is. I think it would be nice to send notices out to address, you know, tenant or owner, here's what's happening. Thank you.
So may I read to you the exact paragraph in the notice of application? So it says, notice is required to be provided to property owners within 300 feet of the site and to parties of record. Please share this notice with others in your neighborhood who may be interested in this project. Property owner, mortgagee, lien holder, vendor, seller, etc., basically addressing those types of people, mm-hmm. please share this notice with tenants and others who may be interested in this project.
Yeah. So it already says that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Mr. Chair.
The public comment period is closed.
Except that you brought up new comments.
I'm sorry. The public comment period is closed.
Can I ask another question related to the Saturday construction? What's the process that the builder would have to go through to get approval for working on Saturdays?
So basically, they just have to submit a request, and most of the time it's granted. The only times it's revoked if they violate some of the construction regulations.
Can I just add, actually, there's an ordinance that's before the city council right now. In fact, the Land and Shore Subcommittee just discussed it last night regarding our weekend or off-hours construction ordinance. So they're discussing it right now, and it'll be going back before the council within the next couple of weeks.
Great, thank you.
Well, let's stay on that. How often is the Saturday construction permit granted?
I mean, just
ballpark. I mean, is it normal to do that for the kinds of projects that come before the Development Commission? And the reason I ask that is because of a couple things have been in adjacent to a major project going on the weekends, and there's no construction there. So I just, it is obviously a legitimate issue, but is it an unusual thing to have a Saturday construction permit, as in more than 50, less than 50%? Is there any way of quantifying that? I get the impression
there would be, and I don't. I wouldn't even venture a guess on the percentages, because we're not just talking about big projects. We're talking about single-family houses and all of the plats and everything.
And so, remodeling comes into that too, doesn't it?
Right. Right. So anything beyond painting, you need to get that off-hour work permit. Right. And so, like I said, and it was brought up earlier, what the Issaquah does is actually it is kind of more restrictive than other cities around, for what it's worth. But I know, like I said, I didn't see it, but I know there was a good discussion about this very issue at the Land and Shore Committee last night. And so I would encourage you, if you want to know more, because our lead building inspector did a presentation answering all these kinds of questions, I would encourage you to watch that video if you get a chance.
Okay. Let us, if there are no more questions, clarifications, we can go on to the next order of business, which is review of the criteria checklist. And because we've been familiar with this process, rather than, excuse me, we all know what the purpose, well, let's, I tell you what, Amy, for the benefit of the new members, why don't you give the objective of the next step that we're going, that the Development Commission has to take regarding this type of development application.
So I'm just as much a newbie on this, because I don't know if you remember. Yeah, Christopher, I think, would be more experienced, because we didn't do this for any of my other projects in Central.
And it has, the process, as Christopher mentioned earlier, it has changed.
Okay, so in some projects, you would use the green sheets if it's outside of Central Issaquah or outside of Old Town. And then for Central Issaquah, we've kind of customized a checklist of items that you go through. And in this case, because it's an Old Town, which has slightly different set of standards than elsewhere, Amy has kind of customized a review checklist for this particular project that hits on all of the required standards. So what we would ask you to do is go through each of those standards and vote on whether you believe that it complies or does not comply. And if it does not comply, then we would ask that you essentially craft a condition or propose a condition so that it can be in compliance.
So we're talking about this, not, I said green sheet earlier, but you said in your earlier presentation, Christopher, you said that used to be called the green sheet. This is the green sheet that we used to use. This is what we're going to be going through now.
Just because of Old Town.
Just because
of this Old Town standards. Yeah.
Just because of Old Town.
Right.
Okay, thank you. All right. So what we will need then is for each commissioner, as we go through the attachment one, to indicate whether or not you believe the application is compliant or meets the standards, okay? So the first one on page one is front yard depth
And the intent, and I'm going to read the intent, but not the rest of it, all right? The intent is to enhance street face as a pedestrian-friendly environment by reinforcing the historic building pattern in downtown. The question is, complies, yes or no?
Yes.
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 Front yard treatment. The intent is to provide a feeling of separation between buildings and public pedestrian realm so that the front yards function as usable outdoor spaces.
Mr. Chair, can I ask you, so in some situations like this where there's a staff has put a condition in, if we say yes and that we agree with a condition?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that's correct. That's absolutely right. If there's a condition noted, we have to indicate our approval of the condition. Let's look at that. Is that the Sunset Way modulation?
It's a pedestrian light. Pedestrian lighting.
Right, that's what I'm looking at. That's what I want to just have up there so we can look at it.
I'm going to try.
There we go. Okay. So that's what we're talking about. Again, feeling a separation between buildings and public pedestrian realms so that the front yards function as usable outdoor spaces. Yes?
Yes, with okay. Condition.
Yes, with condition. Okay. Okay. Entries facing the street. The intent is to provide a clearly defined, welcoming, and safe entry for pedestrians from the sidewalk into the building.
Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
All commissioners?
Yes.
Okay. Next is private outdoor space. The intent is to provide private outdoor spaces that encourage a sense of ownership by the residents.
Yes.
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 Okay.
We have a pee patch.
Site landscape areas to reinforce the character of Old Town and the surrounding natural environment through site landscaping, and that is NA, so we don't vote on that. The next one is, location of parking lots. The intent is to maintain a contiguous, active pedestrian street front along primary pedestrian streets by locating parking lots behind buildings.
Yes.
In this case,
oh, it's underneath the building.
In this case, it's under.
Right. So it's NA.
It's NA. Behind, yes.
Okay. So, route?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes.
Location of driveways. The intent is to maintain a contiguous uninterrupted sidewalk by minimizing, consolidating, and or eliminating driveway access off primary pedestrian streets. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Parking lot landscape. The intent is to reduce the visual impact of parking lots through landscape areas, trellises, and or other architectural features.
Applicable.
Unapplicable.
Because we have the screens. Pedestrian.
I'm sorry, I guess the. There is one
there
condition.
Is a condition
here
that's right.
Yes, a 42 inch.
The garden wall that's right. On the side, on the back there.
Yeah, on the back.
Yeah, this one has several subsections. So we do have, as you read further on, that's where we also recommended a condition to screen that one parking space in the backyard.
Yeah, I thought that's what I was referring to, but I honestly don't. Where is it on here?
It's on
I'm looking at page four.
Page four.
Where's that one down?
Oh, are we talking about a requirement?
So maybe I wasn't very clear here. So under my comments, I simply noted how they complied, right? And then in another section, we do have additional conditions.
Condition four.
Okay.
And
yeah,
maybe I should have mentioned that here,
I don't see the screen. Okay. The next one is pedestrian connections. The intent is to create a network of linkages for pedestrians, including locating building entrances adjacent to sidewalks.
Yes.
And yes.
Yes. Okay. Community gateways. The intent is to highlight gateway areas as an entrance to the community. This is NA. Creekside treatment is NA. Articulation and overall massive bulk of buildings. The intent is to reduce the apparent bulk of buildings by breaking them down into smaller components that are visually consistent with the scale of Old Town.
Yes.
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 Articulation and overall massive bulk of buildings continued to
to provide visual variety along the street face. This is NA because it's of the size. Addressing the corner is NA. Pitched roof forms. The intent is to maintain and continue the historic image of Old Town and its residential neighborhoods.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Entries and front porches to provide a safe and welcoming entry to encourage social interaction among neighbors.
Yes.
No.
Well, yes.
It's bigger than it was previously.
Yeah.
And it meets the standard. If the standard is 4 feet by 4 feet, and they're providing 4 by 6, even though it's relatively small for the size of the building, it still complies, my opinion.
Yes.
Okay. Windows and doors to maintain a lively and active street face. And I'm going to go into the requirement on this one. The windows facing streets shall be transparent. Public spaces adjacent to the street or sidewalks are encouraged to have more and larger areas of transparent glass. And that was specifically addressed in the packet.
Yes.
Yes? Okay.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
All right. Page 9.
Sorry, point of clarification. The packet, the clarification was for the south side of the building to have more windows so they could face the mountains, whereas...
No, actually, I think what we're talking about here is the...
We are talking about the street side.
Right.
But the street side, they didn't add more windows to that side. They add more to the side facing towards the mountains.
Right, but the material also is what there's a concern here, because in some cases, they put...
Reflective
glass, and that's not... We wanted to make sure that wasn't going to be what faces out on Sunset.
And then was there windows added to the workshop that was parking before?
Yes.
Yes.
Basically, they provided large windows. They used to have these teeny tiny, yeah.
Yeah.
That was a blank wall last time.
Yep.
Right. It's on the northeast corner there.
Yeah.
Okay. Materials and architectural details, the intent. To encourage creative expression through diversity of architectural style that enlivens the street. Second is to ensure a standard of quality that will be easily maintained and cared for over time. And three, to encourage the use of materials appropriate to residential development and details that reduce the bulk of larger buildings.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yep. Ground level details when ground floor is commercial. That's NA. Concealed structured parking. The intent is to integrate the parking structures with the surrounding character.
Yes. Yes, as conditions.
Okay. Page 10, excuse me, screening blank walls. The intent is to mitigate blank walls by providing visual interest and reinforcing the historical character of Old Town.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Colors, the color of an individual building shall not overpower the consistency of Old Town. Rather, it should be an integral part of the Old Town character.
Yes.
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 They comply.
Yes.
Page 11, signage, which is NA, and that is it. All right.
Good.
So having reviewed the design standards of Old Town multifamily and having conducted this meeting today with public input, is there any further discussion before we go on to the next
formal step?
Right. In that case, can we get a motion for approval?
Mr. Chair, I move that the Development Commission approve the site development permit for Sunset 7 Apartments SDP 16-00004 with plans, architectural drawings, and technical studies submitted on April 21, 2016. Staff report dated July 6, 2016. With attachments 1 through 7, Exhibit 1, and the staff recommended conditions of approval, including the elimination of the second paragraph of condition 10.
Second.
And moved and seconded.
Second.
Is there any further discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries.
Mr. Chair, I move that the Development Commission direct the Development Services Department to prepare findings of fact and conclusions for review and approval by the Development Commission Chair, affirming the Development Commission's decision to approve the site development permit for Sunset 7 Apartments, SDP 16-00004, based on plans, architectural drawings, and technical studies submitted on April 21, 2016, staff report dated July 6, 2016, with attachments 1 through 7, Exhibit 1, and conditions of approval as adopted by the Development Commission on July 6, 2016. The staff analysis and conclusions in the staff report shall serve as the findings of fact.
Second.
Second.
Moved and second. I'm sorry, I didn't hear who it was, just for who got in first for the second. Okay. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? In that case, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
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 The motion carries unanimously, and the finding of facts will be ready for signature Friday.
Yes.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, the next and final order of business tonight is election of officers. And as I said at the last meeting, I think that having done this for a while, I am no longer going to serve as chairman. So I would like to end this by saying first, thank you very much. This has been a wonderful experience. I really, really have enjoyed this. And I don't know whether this is parliamentarily correct or not, but I would like to enter a nomination for consideration for chairman. And I so nominate Commissioner Richard Sowell.
I second.
I think you just open for nominations.
Yeah, nominations. Yeah, Robert's rules, you have to open for nominations, then do the nomination.
Okay.
So, open for nominations.
Open for nominations.
Second.
As the openings are before us, I nominate Commissioner Sowell to serve as the next chairman of the Development Commission. Is there a second?
Second.
I think you just accept nominations and then close nominations. And
okay. So,
there may be other nominations.
Well, as you can see, we haven't done this very much.
That's right. It's been too long.
Do it forever.
So, are there other nominations?
I move the nomination be closed.
It's been moved and it's been seconded. Is there any further discussion? And then the nominations are closed. All those in favor of the nomination for Commissioner Sowell to be the next chair, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? I tried that and it doesn't work. So congratulations. The next chair is Commissioner Richard Sowell. Again, folks, thank you very, very much. This has been wonderful. And we've got, I'm going to stay around. And we've got some interesting stuff coming in.
We need to elect a vice chair.
That's right. We do need a vice chair. By the way, before we, it'll be next order of business. So we need to have a nomination for a vice chair. Is there a nomination that someone cares to make? Nominations are open.
Nominate Commissioner Morgan.
Commissioner Morgan has been nominated. I second that, nomination. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
Which case, nomination's closed?
I second again.
Okay. Move to close nominations.
Yeah.
Nominations are then. There's no more discussion for that. The nominations are closed for vice chair. All those in favor of Commissioner Morgan serving as vice chair of the Development Commission signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Good. Nominations closed. Commissioner Morgan is the next alternate chair. Thank you very much. And the one thing I would like to bring up is that the final order of business is that the
congratulations, Richard.
The tables show a vacancy on the commission for regular commissions and a vacancy in the alternate.
The website does, yeah.
Yeah, and I think we need to change that, and if we need to, I'll pass the buck to the next commission chair. But we certainly have enough folks that have been that are serving and that are in alternate positions to fill those two that are on the website. Okay.
So before you end the meeting, can we just make a couple of comments?
Absolutely.
Maybe about our outgoing chair. who has to figuratively pass the gavel because it's not here. But you have done a remarkable job. There have been some tough hearings that we've gone through over the last, and at least a couple of years now, I think, and you've done a masterful job, I think, of maintaining decorum, leading us through the decision process very professionally, and I really have appreciated the work that you've done to lead the commission. I think it's been really a remarkable job. So thanks, Randy, for that.
Thank you very much.
I think Commissioner Brennan said it perfectly. You've done an excellent job and been a great advocate for the city and the commissions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I appreciate that very much, and I will just say that folks, many, many times, as happened tonight, I was kept on course by you, and that's what makes this this Development Commission, to me, such a great experience, because we've got enough insight, enough dedication, and enough knowledge here that we can self-correct in the course of the process and do it diplomatically and effectively. So this has just been a hoot. I wish Commissioner Sola an equally enjoyable experience.
Can I make a comment, Mr. Chair? I did my personal comments to Randy before we started this meeting, and I appreciate his insight on approaching the problem from looking outside the box, and that's what I told Randy. You know, I appreciate his leadership, you know, the way that he guide the whole the meetings, how it should be gone through, asking questions that nobody even thought about asking outside the box. And so the leadership that you brought to this commission was great, Randy. Thank you very much. And I hope you'll take a break and then come back as a chairman again.
Thank you very much. In that case, is there any further comment? Onward, gentlemen.
He's not revised.
Actually, you do have a gavel.
There we are.
Golden gavel.
No, no, you have to accept it.
There you go.
Perfect. I was, you know, he's fighting against you the whole way.
That was.